I've requested them to only record us and not you. Because most of you would be fine, but some of you may not be comfortable. So to avoid that, we have a situation that, but you would be heard in the recordings. That I thought I'd let you know. I'm Dibyesh Anand. I'm head of politics and international relations at University of Westminster. And one of the rationale for having this discussion was because we often talk of China, rise of China in our classes, but we also talk in terms of China-UK relations. How the entire world is shifting or not shifting, changing the policies and policy priorities according to what is happening in the world, which is rise of major non-Western powers, including China. China is not the only one. You have India, Brazil, and others, but China is the primary one. But as all of you, I'm sure, would know, that the timing is not coincidental. The timing is, I mean, Xi Jinping is coming tomorrow. I have no idea what time. I'm not really interested in him as such. All I know is that he'd be welcomed rather well by the British state. You'd have a queen presiding over a constitutional democracy, inviting a communist dictator, I can't find any other word, communist dictator, to the UK, which is fine. I'm sure all states have to do those things. But to what extent does a democratic state have to transform its national and foreign policy priority to accommodate a rising power? Because one thing which this particular government, David Cameron, George Osborne, and others have been insisting upon is they want to make UK as the preferred partner of China in the West. So you have a situation where different countries, Germany was one of them, France is another, Britain, all of them competing to be the better partner for China. So it might be one of those unique situations in global history in the last 300 years when an emerging power is being wooed by a large number of existing, not major, but medium-sized power. So it's an interesting question to ponder upon. Why are they doing it, right? And what impact it has on. And as you would have seen in the event announcement, I mean, the idea is not only to say what is happening, but why is it happening, what impact it has for British public, what impact it has on the US, for instance, what impact it has on the main people concerned, which is people inhabiting what's People's Republic of China, to what extent it may have impact there. So there are different topics that we'll be covering. As you see, we have quite a number of speakers. I would like to thank speakers in advance and those who suggested those speakers, because it was done at very last minute. I'm not like a British state or Chinese state that plans for 10, 15 years or whatever. British don't plan that much, at least the Chinese do. I'm not that good at it, but it was a last minute thing, and I'm really grateful to all of you for coming, taking time out and attending this, because it's quite important. And one of the idea behind this event was to remind ourselves and remind others that there's no reason why in a democracy like Britain, we should accept the government version as the only version. Government's version today is you need to do everything to placate China. And the idea is there's no reason why you need to accept it. We could also question it. We've got five different speakers, right? We have got Dr. Eva Pills from King's College. And my apologies, in fact, I kept sending her an email to kings.ac.uk, which doesn't work. It's kcl.ac.uk. Anyway, thanks for coming. She's an expert, so I don't want to go into detail because you could read about her. She's from King's College. We have got Matteo Mecacci, who's from International Campaign for Tibet. We've got Isabel Hilton from ChinaDialogue.net and has done a lot of other things. We've got Corinna-Barbara Francis, who's an independent consultant and has written extensively about China again. We've got Ellen Bork, who's from you're from Foreign Policy Initiative, but also Henry Jackson Society. And that's it. Let me start. What we'll be doing is we'll be having around 6 to 7 minutes of short speech by each one of us on slightly different topic. Not me. I've already spoken 6 to 7 minutes. We'll have it from them. And then I may have certain questions that are meant for all of them, right? And then we'll open up the for question answer. So when you are asking your question answer, please make sure if you want to introduce yourself, just introduce yourself. If you don't, it's okay. We understand. But keep your question or comment brief, unless I'm letting you speak for a couple of minutes. That's an exception, right? So let's start with, Corinna-Barbara, right? And we are being recorded. I think I have to keep in front of you.
thank you so much, Professor Anand, for the invitation. And Professor Anand has raised some very challenging questions for the roundtable here, including whether the UK has ushered in a new phase of engagement with China based on business interest at the expense of human rights, what impact this will have on UK citizens, the people in Britain, and a broader question of where human rights should fit in into the UK's and possibly a broader issue just from nations in general dealing with China. I think one of the easiest question of these to answer, which I'll start with, is that indeed I think the UK has shifted towards a new basis for its foreign policy towards China. It's not radically, it's been progressive, but I think in the last few years we can definitely see, you know, as opposed to his earlier meeting with the Dalai Lama in 2012, you know, we have seen just over the last few months a refusal to meet with the Dalai Lama on the part of David Cameron, and all the pronouncements that we're seeing about this golden era of engagement with China. But it's gone beyond pronouncements, and it's gone beyond just a neglect, you might say, of human rights. I mean, some of the behavior we saw in the recent trips of UK leaders to the UK and to China in September, I mean, they're not only not bringing up issues, but I think that they went even farther in their behavior in terms of going along with a Chinese agenda. For instance, you know, taking a trip, a visit to Xinjiang, which is where an ethnic minority, Uyghur ethnic minorities are concentrated, and in a sense playing along with the sort of propaganda scenario is taking a step further in reinforcing, you know, the Chinese authorities vision of things. And, you know, not mentioning, of course, you know, going to this region and not mentioning Ilham Tohti, who is a moderate Uyghur professor advocating on behalf of Uyghurs in China, is taking things really a step farther than we've seen in the past. But I think it also goes beyond just the human rights arena. I think the UK has taken some actions that have really supported China's initiatives in the global on the global stage, in helping China to undertake initiatives to sort of reconfigure international organizations. So one example of this is UK support of the China's initiative to build an Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. China initiated this in October of 2014. Within the first like 5 months, only five countries signed up to it, and the US was quite opposed to the initiative. When the UK signed up in March of this year, within 2 weeks of the UK signing up, 15 countries signed up. So the UK played a really critical role in shifting the global initiative and global support for that. We can certainly debate the merits of the international, you know, that this bank, but the reality is that UK did play a very important role in supporting China in that international initiative. I think there's a number of things that I think I find of concern in the UK's approach. The first is that it does, implicitly or not, rest on a kind of a viewpoint that the human rights situation in China has not deteriorated, or if not improved, not gotten as bad as we, I think, know that it has. Just this morning on Radio 4, I was kind of, you know, thinking about this evening's presentation, heard a former ambassador to the UK talking about Xi Jinping's trip and saying, actually able to say, that in certain respects human rights in China have improved recently. I would argue very strongly, and I think there's a really strong consensus among experts and academics and practitioners in the field that there has been a very sharp deterioration in human rights in China. I'm just going to mention a few things, and I think some other panelists will follow up on that. But since July of this year, we've seen at least 250 lawyers, other legal practitioners in China detained, disappeared, or criminally charged. Xi Jinping's new regime has much more aggressively attacked civil society, sort of a budding civil society in China. It has really gone after religious groups in a more aggressive way. Earlier, over the last year or so, it kind of really went for a Christian community in eastern China. One of the areas in China where Christians are very dominant, it went in and insisted that hundreds of crosses were, dismantled from on the top of the churches. I think they're also going to another level, let me just backtrack that. I think another way in which this the UK approach is disturbing is that it's not simply a backtracking of human rights in China, but an actual active, very proactive, very systematic building of a new type of authoritarian system in China. So the Xi Jinping is attempting to impose an ideological conformity over the population, to really purge public discourse of any views, opinions that don't conform to the party's line on things. They have, in a wholesale way, undercut China's budding civil society. And a multi-year effort to build the rule of law undercut in these last few years, and I think we're also going to hear a bit more about that. Another aspect of this is there's this view that somehow that China's too strong and that Xi Jinping represents this sort of new, powerful, strong man. I think we can question that. Xi Jinping does appear as the kind of new strong man of China, of this sort of rising China with a powerful, huge budget, strong military, progressively strong military, etc. But I often, I think first of all, lots of experts will dispute this view of a strong leader or a strong China. I often sort of feel like when I think of Xi Jinping or the scenario in China, sort of the Wizard of Oz scenario, it's like you have this booming voice and terrifying images and terrifying the public and able to sort of put fear in the hearts of the population until the curtain is kind of drawn back, and what is revealed is a very different picture. I think looking much more deeply into what's happening in China, many experts, I think, are arguing that there is really a crisis in governance in China. So that what appears on the surface, to be sort of strong, is underneath actually quite weak institutions and weak governance, and in fact a crisis of governance. And I think that we are more familiar with the sort of attack on human rights activists in China. But I think what we don't think about as much, perhaps, is the way in which Xi Jinping's policies have, in a sense, also created a culture of fear, and you might even say of terror, within the elite and within the official sphere. Just recently, I don't know if you've heard, but there's obviously been this really intense campaign of anti-corruption in China. So Xi Jinping is sort of stuck in a way if he doesn't pursue, dealing with the crisis of corruption in China. I think he's afraid for his regime, but if he does, as he has, it also has created some real dilemmas. I think officials in China are so afraid that there's been almost a paralysis within governance in China. There was news just recently that almost 250 officials in China had been charged with quote-unquote inaction. They were so afraid to actually govern, to actually undertake their administrative tasks, and to actually use their budgets for fear of being attacked by the corruption campaign, that they just were not doing anything. They weren't using their budgets. This is 250 officials, or you know, in just 1 month that were charged in this way. So we can see that this is, you know, the kind of strongman tactics have really, you know, in a sense, paralyzed to an extent the officialdom. And there are lots of other indicators of distress within the governing system. I think it's interesting that recently there was a debate in the U.S. following an article written by David Chambao, who has been recognized as a fairly conservative American academic, who was kind of predicting the end game for the CCP in China. And following that, there was a kind of a debate where they surveyed dozens of different academics. And it's just very interesting, it's very telling that they are having this debate, you know, sort of who thinks that the CCP will fall within a certain 5 years, for instance. It's presenting this very ironic situation that the UK government is embracing this new rising power at a time when actually I think there are so many signs that this regime is in big trouble. And we won't have time to go into too much detail, but there are also many other economic indicators, you know, of the sort of dilemma. I think that any foreign policy has to be based on a very, very hard-nosed analysis of what type of regime that nation is dealing with, and I don't feel that the UK and many other countries have done that really strong analysis. And a final thing, and I'm sure we will raise this in the question and answers, but the question of human rights versus economic engagement, I think this is a really a false dilemma. You know, and I think it's presented in this way by politicians in order to excuse or to explain their sort of pro-business, but it's definitely not an either-or. And in fact, the arguments that human rights activists make, that human rights are so key to a healthy, progressive, well-governed China, are numerous. And we can also very, very make strong arguments that a society in China that is respectful of human rights, where the media plays an important role in constraining economic behavior and political actions, is critical not only to China, but to the broad community. I think I may be running out of time soon, but in the question and answer, we can look at some of those very, very direct ways in which production in China, in which the economy, the society in China will have an impact, you know, on the global stage and on UK citizens in a very direct way.
Thank you, Corinna-Barbara. Now we have got Isabel Hilton. And
thank you very much, Dibyesh. Good evening, everybody. Well, it's going to be a busy week, I think, for all of us who try to follow this this relationship. Just to go back on the questions that Dibyesh asked a bit earlier on. I mean, I think we all remember that 2 years ago, high-level visits from the UK to China were pretty much in the deep freeze, and there was a certain visible desperation on the part of the UK government to try to get back to Beijing, which they eventually did. But David Cameron did start out committed to raising human rights, as he put it, not for not because it's a moral or ethical thing to do, though one would hope that it was anyway, but because, as he put it, the British people expected him to. We don't hear that so much now, and clearly, you know, it's quite embarrassing, I think, for the UK to see the Chinese press and the Chinese ambassador in London confidently predicting that nobody would be so ill-mannered as to mention human rights during this visit. I agree with the previous speaker that discussing human rights or doing business is not an either-or. It's a matter of you know, different sides of government. I have my own views about how much government should be involved in business anyway. I think it's probably better for business to do business and governments to manage political relations. That is, after all, what we expect them to do. I do, though, think that the government-to-government conversation on human rights is highly problematic and full of hypocrisies pretty much on all sides. I think it's been particularly problematic from the Western side since the Iraq War, since the United States indulged in imprisonment without trial, torture, kidnapping, and various other things that we, at least I think in my generation, expected never to see again from our own governments. And so the Chinese are right, and other countries that raise this point are right to say that this discourse at a government level is full of hypocrisy. It is. We don't criticize Saudi Arabia the way we criticize other countries, and we should acknowledge that this is a very, very flawed discourse. That does not mean that we should abandon the conversation. Since the human rights conversation moved behind closed doors, I think we are all rightly suspicious that it has lost robustness. I was told by a British official that, just to give you a flavour of the kind of promises that politicians make and how they keep them, when Tony Blair visited China, he had promised to raise the issue of Tibet, which he did. But he did it by, sitting down, beginning a conversation and observing that he understood that the weather in Lhasa was good that day before moving on to other business. He could therefore say that he had raised the issue of Tibet. So put not your faith in politicians on this one. I think that they tend to disappoint. But if you look at what should we expect then? Well, if you look at the guest list, for instance, for the state banquet at the White House for the Xi Jinping's recent visit to the United States, you will see that Sophie Richardson, who runs the China desk for Human Rights Watch, was a guest at that dinner. I don't think we're going to see many human rights defenders, civil society human rights defenders, invited to the state banquet in Britain. And I think what the British government can and should do is to make it clear that, after all, this is the country where Amnesty International was born. And I think that's an important part of British identity and British soft power. And the British government should make clear that it stands behind civil society organisations that do this work, because without that support, they are the weaker. Anyway, I would have other requests of the UK government in handling this issue during this visit. I remember on a previous visit, I think it was Jiang Zemin, there was a lot of pressure on British citizens who wished to demonstrate in support of human rights in Tibet and other parts of China, being sort of pushed out of the sight of the imperial gaze so that, you know, the visiting dignitary would not have to look at British citizens making their point on British streets, exercising their own right of free speech in their own country. I think that it's pretty shaming when British citizens are tidied away for fear of causing offence to a visiting statesman. So freedom of speech and association here, freedom to demonstrate in our own country, on our own streets, an assertion for support of those NGOs that do uphold human rights. I think these are minima that we should demand of a UK country. So just going back to who is making British foreign policy and how we got here, I think we've all been a little surprised by the emergence of George Osborne as a major foreign policy thinker, since his experience and indeed his practice doesn't suggest that he's very suited for this. You know, we've heard about his recent visit to China when he went to Xinjiang, apparently without hesitation. He also made a speech at the Shanghai Stock Exchange. Stock Exchange had experienced some turmoil in the course of the summer. In the course of that speech, he said several times that Britain and China should stick together, and he seemed to be pledging that Britain would be China's best friend in the West. Other governments have tried to do this before and found that the relationship probably didn't last very long. But it raises a number of questions. Is this a new foreign policy? Is the UK going to stick with China under all circumstances? If not, what circumstances would cause this policy to be revisited? If Britain is going to stick with China in all circumstances, what does that mean for the rather more long-standing relationships that the UK has had and on which its foreign policy has been based, the relationship with the United States, for instance, which shortly after that speech was engaged in a fairly direct confrontation in the South China Sea with Chinese ships? What about its relationship with India, with China's neighbours, with Australia? What would happen were China to seek to recover Taiwan by force in the event, for example, of a Taiwanese election returning a government that was determined to declare independence? The United States is committed to the defence of Taiwan. How would Britain choose in those circumstances? I think we have been manoeuvred into a relationship with China that has not been adequately debated, and the implications of which are really quite profound. I should say that I've been involved with China one way or another for most of my adult life, and I am very much a proponent of constructive relations with China. But constructive relations start from a conviction of one's own values, it seems to me, and I think that what we have slightly lost sight of in this instance is the fact that if we do not assert those values, what is in any event an asymmetric relationship in terms of size and power becomes the more asymmetric because of a willingness apparently to please. I think that UK international relations are and should be multifaceted. They're not just about business. And I repeat that I have reservations about how much government should be involved in business. International relations are not just a function of economic policy either, any more than citizenship can be reduced to a question of how much tax an individual pays. Citizenship is a rounded concept. It involves obligations as well as rights, and foreign policy ought also to encompass that. So why are we doing this? Well, it would appear, for reasons largely self-created, that Mr. Osborne regards China as the preferred investor in the UK. Britain is a very open economy, as we know. Mr. Osborne is committed to a balanced budget. He has a need for infrastructure investment and an unwillingness to borrow in order to finance it. He also apparently is less enthusiastic about such entities as Canadian pension funds, which would invest in British infrastructure. This is pleasing to China for a number of reasons. There are several OECD countries, in fact, restrict certain kinds of investment for reasons of national security or lack of transparency. There is also a long list of things that the UK is not allowed to invest in China, by the way, so this again is an asymmetric relationship. This moment coincides with diminishing returns in China as the economy slows, investments are earning less, a structural shift is underway in the Chinese economy, which means there's really much less easy money at home, so there's a lot of Chinese finance looking for a home. There's a lot of surplus capacity in the Chinese economy, particularly in steel and cement, which is looking for new places to be deployed. And the economy has reached the point at which the export of more advanced technologies has to take over from the export of low-end manufacturing, which has sustained it for the last 25, 30 years. So there is considerable interest in the Chinese part, for instance, in being allowed to first invest and then construct nuclear power plants in the United Kingdom, because it serves as a convenient jumping-off platform, if you like, for a possible export market. China does export nuclear plants to date. They haven't been completed, but it has a deal with Romania, a deal with Pakistan and with Argentina, but none with an OECD country, so this would be a considerable coup. I think that I have a number of problems with the nuclear deals under discussion. Hinkley Point C, and I have different objections to different stages of it. So my objection to Hinkley Point C is the fact that this is conceivably the worst deal ever foisted on the British consumer, in which, in order to finance the construction of a nuclear plant which has never successfully been completed, this design, which is a French design from EDF, is 7 years over schedule and three times over budget in Finland. It's, I think, 5 years over schedule and three times over budget in France. There are two under construction in China, which are also late, have not been completed. And so this one, at Hinkley Point C, in which the French are seeking to recover all the overrun costs in their previous failed attempts, it's a poor idea. It's such a poor idea that nobody terribly wants to invest in it. So in order to get the investment from China to finance Hinkley Point C, George Osborne has promised, this, by the way, is an example of you know, politicians double speak. This government has said that there will be no subsidy for civil nuclear power. Everybody knows it can't be built without favourable conditions, to put it mildly. The favourable conditions in this instance are that the British consumer has been committed by the Chancellor to paying more than twice the current wholesale price for electricity for 35 years index-linked. And that will go on everybody's electricity bills. This from a government that said it can't afford renewables. This also at a time when electricity demand is falling, and when the UK electricity grid is very highly connected to the European grid, which means that the concept of baseload power, which nuclear plants are meant to fulfil, is increasingly discredited as a need in a responsive distributed energy system. I'm sorry, I've gone on to energy, but that's my objection to Hinkley Point. It's a very bad deal. The next bad deal, in my view, would be that China would design and build a second nuclear plant in Essex, Bradwell in Essex. And as I first became aware of this, design, build and operate this plant. We've seen in the last few days serious objections being raised in the intelligence communities and security communities about what it means to allow a Chinese state-owned enterprise access to UK critical infrastructure. I regard that as very concerning in terms of security. If the Chinese continue to operate this plant, even more concerning, because you're taking a very, very large bet over 40 years that there will be no serious breach in relations between the UK and China, in which a functioning nuclear plant on Britain's grid could be used as leverage against the UK government. And I think that is a bet for which we have absolutely no security and no guarantee. So, is this kind of thing necessary for the UK to do business with China? I don't think so. The most successful countries in terms of business with China are Germany and the United States. Neither of them indulge in this kind of behaviour. And ironically, one of the areas in which Britain was well placed to have a constructive conversation with China on climate policy is precisely an area in which Mr. Osborne's Treasury has been to say the least of it, a laggard in the last couple of years. China, by contrast, has a serious climate policy and is committed to a deep decarbonisation of the Chinese economy. The UK used to be, but that has been undermined by a series of measures which Mr. Osborne has undertaken. So that conversation has not thrived, and again, I'm told that the Chinese were far keener to talk about climate change than the UK Treasury was. So, on to Dibyesh's question on what the UK should do to adjust to a rising power, well, clearly you have to adjust to a rising power. There are many adjustments, including in the voting rights in multilateral institutions, which I would firmly support. Clearly we have to engage with China. We need to, we have adjusted in the sense that China is a member of the WTO, which was hugely significant for China's economic progress. All kinds of adjustments are being made and will be made, but these should not include revising our own values and commitments as a liberal democracy. Nor, in my view, does this advance UK foreign policy. There was a very interesting paper that's released today by Robin Niblett, who is the director of the Royal Institute of International Affairs, Chatham House, looking at how the UK should maintain its influence in a very rapidly changing world. And he dismisses the idea that outside the European Union or outside its traditional alliances, the UK can make bilateral arrangements for long with rising powers. He simply doesn't see that as a likely route for Britain to take. He advocates instead a much firmer relationship with the European Union, and if the European Union could ever be persuaded to have a foreign policy, that should be our route. That's another long conversation, and I know Dibyesh won't let me get into it, but I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Isabel. We have got Dr. Isabel from King's College. So.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Dibyesh, for the invitation. And I would like to pick up from the idea of constructive engagement with China and suggest that one of the problems with engaging appropriately, and I do think that, of course, engagement should be constructive, both at the level of government and at the level of many civil society organizations, other entities that engage with China, there is an insufficient understanding of the current deterioration of rule of law in China and its sort of structural background that impedes appropriately reacting to these changes. And so I think that in some ways this echoes a little bit what Corinna-Barbara Francis has said before. I would like to suggest that what we have seen over the past couple of years, especially under the Xi Jinping administration, has been something like a shift from a paradigm of expecting incremental reforms in the direction of better rule of law and better human rights protection to a new situation where the party state is reasserting itself and is much more clearly and unfortunately also much more harshly repressive of those elements within Chinese society itself that keep on pushing towards better rule of law. Taking this back a little bit historically, I would say that in some ways this reflects, this is a reaction to what we can describe as a kind of rise of civil society in China over the past 30, 35 years. So basically, sort of in the post-Mao reform and opening era. We can see that there has been a rebuilding, a strengthening, amongst other things, of the legal system. And I think that for a very long time, that rebuilding of legal institutions, the flood of legislation, the creation of an important, very sort of in terms of numbers, very large legal profession, but also the creation of civil society organizations engaged at all sorts of areas, various levels in the in helping Chinese citizens protect their legal rights, has effected very important changes, I think, in Chinese society, just as much as the economic opening, the growth of business, and the very, very obvious sort of prosperity, rise in prosperity on average amongst Chinese citizens. So that, in some ways, I think, was accompanied by not only at the level of foreign governments, but also of transnational, international civil society, an expectation that gradually, incrementally, China would move in a direction of better rule of law, more liberal values, sort of an embrace of human rights ideas, and ultimately, perhaps also a more open and democratic society. What is important, I think, to the issue of UK-China relations and more widely China's international relations about this paradigm of incremental benign reforms is that foreign governments exchange programs with China, and many international civil society organizations came to rely on this expectation. At the same time, of course, there was also a rise in repression of civil society as it strengthened, and we have over the past 10 years especially seen more and more individuals and organizations sort of been affected by repression, the detentions, the persecution, the surveillance, etc., etc. And what is now changing, I think, under Xi Jinping's government is that this hope of incremental reform, liberal reform, has been very much, very clearly, I think, rejected by the party state. We can see that, for instance, in the recent crackdown on lawyers, which Corinna-Barbara Francis already mentioned. This is something that started in last July. Hundreds of persons, including lawyers, including other human rights defenders, have been affected. What the party state, I think, is aiming at is really a kind of remodeling of its current system of governance on very explicitly anti-liberal, on a very explicitly anti-liberal model. It is much more assertively putting the party in control of the legal system. It is very explicitly renouncing the values that are central to a rule of law state. Is also, in contrast to earlier years, it is being very assertive and open about the way in which it represses civil society. So to give an example, the party state this summer has chosen to display some of the detained lawyers on national television making confessions of sort of wrongdoing to the entire nation, to a nationwide public. And I think that the reason why the party state is doing this is really because it wishes to, it's sort of announcing to the public that things have changed, its model of governance has changed, and that criticism of the government by human rights lawyers, free reporting of course, implicitly critical reporting by journalists is no longer going to be tolerated. So what does this mean for us, and what does it mean for transnational civil society? Well, I think that what we've been observing over the past couple of years is that as their Chinese counterparts came more and more under pressure, were more and more at risk, for instance, of themselves being detained, we've seen civil society organizations, and I would include in that, to some extent at least, academia, academic institutions, sort of outside of China, become more and more cautious, or we might say more and more intimidated about continued exchange and collaboration with civil society in China. That, of course, is very bad news. It's bad news certainly for China, for those who wish to promote rule of law and human rights values and so on in China. But it's also bad news for us, because effectively what it means, I think, is that we are gradually, and perhaps quite in some ways quite unthinkingly, beginning to accept self-censorship and pressure that comes from the Chinese, this more and more authoritarian Chinese state, and is sort of exported outside of China, is exported to here. I think that structurally speaking, what foreign governments are doing, including, it does appear, the British government, is quite similar to what international, transnational civil society feels, at least in some instances, compelled to do, namely a kind of cautious and reaction of that sort of a cautious, wary reaction and increasingly avoidance of issues and themes that might displease the Chinese government. And I think that the very recent admonitions, for instance, from the Chinese ambassador to the UK about being gentlemanly and avoiding certain topics such as human rights during the state visit are a pretty good example for an increased expectation on the part of the Chinese government that outside entities will comply with this expectation of self-censorship. So, of course, there is no perfect solution to this issue, partly because the repression that goes on in China is in the control of the party state. It is the Chinese government that decides to take these measures and to intimidate. And I don't think that any outside entity has any direct influence on these very unfortunate changes, on this deterioration of the rule of law situation. But certainly I think that entities on the outside, in particular foreign governments, have an obligation not only in terms of their values, in terms of human rights values, but also towards their own civil society to react to take note of these changes, of this increasing repression, and to speak up, to be critical of human rights violations, such as the recent crackdowns on lawyers, journalists, communities of faith, etc., etc. Because not doing so, I think, raises the danger of a kind of silence and acquiescence that ultimately could make us, or at least could make our governments, complicit in this deterioration of rule of law in China. So I think that my time is up, but I'm sure we can sort of continue this discussion during the Q&A.
Thank you. And we have got next speaker, Matteo Mecacci, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, and
yes.
From International Campaign for Tibet.
I will try to be brief so that we can also open, quite soon also for questions. But I want to just make some remarks, starting with something that might, seem maybe too much. But I think we are on the verge of a political disaster. And I'm not talking only about the United Kingdom, but one, as students of political theory and international relations, one of the pillars of modern political theory was and has been and should continue to be that democracy, rule of law, and human rights are essential for any nation state to be able to thrive and for people to enjoy their freedom. And what is happening in the case of the rise of China on the world stage is China is able to change this theory. I mean, there is a growing acceptance by many governments that are democratic that you can have development, you can have progress, and you can have happiness for people, and I'm sure that might be true for many people also, with a capitalist system that is authoritarian. And this is becoming accepted by everybody without any political pushback. And this is very dangerous because we have come out in Europe last century out of two world wars. And these two world wars were produced by and caused by nationalist states who had enough resources to start and wage wars. The rise of an authoritarian country with a strong military and a strong economy would not be the first case, China. We had it in the past. And the answer after those wars was to try to create alliances through NATO and through the European Union where like-minded countries that would share these values would come together and would try to contain the policies of authoritarian states. This has not produced world peace. There have been wars, there have been massacres, there have been genocides over the last 60 years, but at least there has been a containment thanks to the existence of this alliance. So what China and Russia, on another hand, are trying to do is to break those alliances, to break that argument that in order to maintain peace and to have world prosperity, you don't need to have democracy, you don't need to have human rights. You can have authoritarian countries that can provide food, basic health service, and that would be fine. The problem is that these authoritarian countries, in order to survive, they need to promote nationalistic policies. They need to create enemies all the time, whether it's the former imperialists, whether it's other governments, whether it's the Tibetans, whether it's the Uyghurs, whether it's the Chinese lawyers. They need to create these enemies to tell their own people that they need to have a strong government that has control on the population to maintain control and peace. So this is what is happening. And in the case of the UK, this is a clear example. It's not the only one. It's not the only one in Europe. And even on the side of the US, where I think there is in the political establishment an understanding that China is a competitor, is not just a partner for economic partnership. But even there hasn't been enough attention to how do you counter it? How do you build a strategy with other countries to try to avoid that this new situation in which you have to work together, you have to do business together, doesn't lead you to be, divided and being basically subdued. I mean, what China has done with the UK, they have subdued UK policy to China's needs. This has started, famously now, everybody's writing in 2012, there was a meeting of David Cameron with the Dalai Lama. Nothing special. UK Prime Minister had been meeting the Dalai Lama for many years before. Actually, in 2012, the Dalai Lama had just given up his political authority in 2001, just becoming a religious leader, so devolving its political authority and giving a clear signal to China that he's not interested in going back to rule Tibet. This is not the issue. The question is respecting the culture, the religious traditions of Tibetans. And so, but China picked that to say, you cannot do that. And if you do that, I'm not gonna have any political relations. If you buy into that argument and you allow them to win that, and Cameron, we know, has been indirectly saying that he will not meet again with the Dalai Lama, they politically won. So they won once, and then they start for the, what is next? So next, you know, Xinjiang, or next is the South China Sea, or next will be, who knows? Because when you have this kind of government that wants to change this international balance, not just economic balance, that the economic balance has already changed. I mean, the World Trade Organization, they're gonna do their own bank, they, at some point the IMF will be reformed. They need to change the political balance. And so they will continue to push. And so unless, you know, democratic governments push back together with China, which has, you know, now the second biggest economy in the world, actually the third, the second biggest economy in the world would be the European Union, if there was a European Union in terms of foreign policy that could talk to China. They would have, you know, we would have the manpower and the economic power to be able to negotiate. But when you have Osborne or my Prime Minister Renzi going to China to negotiate, you look at the size of China, 1,300,000,000 people, and UK, Italy, one province of China. So what kind of negotiating power do you have on the political level? So this is a failure. This is a complete disaster, because China is going to continue, and the only reason why they might stop is because they fail on their own. If their own system doesn't allow them to continue to grow, if, you know, the Chinese economy will slow, they don't have an independent judiciary, they don't have a free press, they don't have ways, you know, to address also the needs of their people in a prosperous way. So our hope at this point seems to be that our, you know, past belief in democracy and, you know, the rule of law might apply for China. So meaning that with this authoritarian system, they might not be able to adapt to this new situation. But this is very, I think it's very concerning for many of us, because this is not really about China. It's also, it's about us. You know, what kind of society do we want to live in, and do we want to continue to grow? Do we really think that we can just get away with our human rights and freedoms and that would be fine? So I think this is something that I'm, you know, I'm glad that over these days, I think, I mean, the British media at least is starting to have a discussion about this. And, you know, today we had an opportunity in the British Parliament to continue that. But this is something that I think for people who are engaged in studying political theory, to start thinking at a deeper level, because what is happening in the relationship with China and also with the Russian Federation will determine the future that European Union and, you know, the United States will take. I must say that, you know, recently Xi Jinping, right, you know, a few weeks ago, he was in Washington, D.C., and he was also received with a state visit. He had the dinner, and some of our friends were there. And, you know, they didn't get much out of, you know, the state visit, except what they wanted. And what they want from this state visit is a recognition of legitimacy. What the Chinese government is more eager to get from the West is a recognition that they are a legitimate government to be able to tell to their people. And they know that they have a problem. There was, you know, there have been recent opinion polls last July. Almost 80% of the British people think that there is a big problem of human rights violations, both in China and in Tibet. almost 90% of the people have a favorable or very favorable opinion of the Dalai Lama. Only 3% of the British people think that the human rights situation in Tibet is satisfactory. So, I mean, they know they have a problem, and in Xi Jinping, in his interview with Reuters yesterday, he said that, you know, the British public opinion has a good opinion about, you know, China. It's not true. So they really need to have the, you know, to be honored by the oldest democracy in Europe to be able to say to their own people, you see, we are respected in the world for what we are, not for what we need to be. And this is very dangerous. This is very dangerous, and, you know, for the Chinese people, aspiration to, you know, live in a democracy, but also for us, because when you start doing this for economic reasons, there will be other reasons why you might be compelled to give up on that. So I think this is a conversation that will continue, unfortunately, because this policy of pushing European governments to concede more and more politically from China is happening and will continue.
Thank you very much. And we have got the final speaker, Ellen Bork from Foreign, what was it called? I keep forgetting. I know Henry Jackson Society is one
from
of
America.
Yeah. She's just visiting fellow at Henry Jackson Society, but she's originally a senior fellow Foreign Policy Initiative.
Thank you very much. I'm very aware that everyone, that you've all been sitting for a long time, and so, but I was invited to give sort of an American perspective, and I thought what I would throw out for your consideration is that, to a visitor, it seems to me that Great Britain and its approach with under Mr. Cameron, under its approach to China, is kind of going through something similar to what my country did in the 1990s, in a certain way, but with two very important exceptions or differences, one of which it has to do with the lack of strategic responsibilities that Great Britain has as compared to the United States, and the other is the geopolitical situation, the resurgence of big authoritarian regimes challenging democratic norms very confidently. So that's those two things, I think, make what's going on now very worrisome. Otherwise, we could look at it and say, does it really matter what Great Britain does? But I think it does for all the reasons that my colleagues on the panel have said and for some other ones. So taking you back to the 1990s, in my country, sort of the outlook was that the Cold War was over. There was going to be a peace dividend. There was a very popular intellectual idea popularized by Frank Fukuyama that the end of history had arrived. We didn't need to worry about ideology anymore. And determinism, everything that was going to make everything all right. And this sort of the use of economics, trade and investment to shape politics was all going to work out really well. That no one imagined that it might strengthen bad tendencies, only that it was going to sort of lead to all these really great things and liberal democracy, maybe not democracy, but, you know, China would move in a politically pleasing direction. And this, of course, ignored all kinds of factors, the character of the Communist Party regime, their leaders' desires, imperatives, and incentives, which are very different. But frankly, my country projected onto China's leadership these ideas that we wanted to, and also very much ignored somehow the vast majority of China itself, which are the people. And I find this very similar to the kind of rhetoric that you're hearing from Mr. Osborne. We want to be China's best partner. It seems to me that he's focusing on a very narrow section of China when he says that, and when he uses that to then justify certain, you know, priorities. Also this, you know, the visit to Xinjiang, which is really kind of unbelievable, not to mention the lack of comment, but just this lack of context, lack of understanding. I mean, it really is shocking. I think it's very diminishing to the British government leadership. I just am really distressed by it. So in any case, again, back to my country where this sort of engagement idea took hold. And I want to stress, this is not a partisan approach on my point of view. Both of my country's political parties have generally the same approach to China and have had. And there's a little bit of differences sometimes, but generally, everybody embraced the engagement idea. Everybody wanted to get rid of our lever of most favored nation trade status, this beneficial trade status that we had, that that China got, but was subject to an annual review. And that annual review gave Congress the right to bring up all kinds of unpleasant ideas and discuss it before a vote. Practically speaking, this never was probably never really at risk for China. It was directly, immediately after Tiananmen massacre, it was. And I think that the United States failed to see some very interesting indications that China was willing to make concessions on human rights and politics immediately after that. But as you may remember, President George H.W. Bush sent his national security advisor over right away. And really, I mean, the best you can say about it is that they failed to recognize the importance of that moment. They were much more interested in that moment in U.S.-China relations and that geostrategic moment where the Cold War was over, the China that had been the counterweight to the Soviet Union, you know, no longer needed to be play that role with the United States, and the United States had leverage, had cards to play, could have responded differently at a very crucial moment when there was also, you know, had been some limited political reform in China. Not exciting, but certainly, you know, there was reason to at least look into that. So that didn't happen. Instead, this sort of feeling of engagement took over, which was really kind of a disguise for business interests. You may remember also President Clinton, initially under pressure from some leading lights in Congress, did make MFN, this trade relations, conditional on human rights very briefly, but then he abandoned that completely and moved ahead. And again, I'm not being partisan. When the United States moved to give China permanent normal trade relations and make this permanent, everyone supported it, including George Bush, George W. Bush, who was running for president at the time. Another important difference, though, I think, is that even though I find a lot of what American interests in China were serving, these business interests, there was nevertheless the hope that that kind of engagement would lead to political change. People justified our policy on those grounds as much as on sort of trade, or more than trade grounds. Americans felt they needed to have a reason to do that. I don't think that that's the case here. I think that's for a number of reasons. I don't think it's just that I don't think it's just craven immorality. I think it's a different sense of what Britain's role in the world is. It's a much smaller role than the United States. It's certainly a much smaller role in Asia, and the United States has these important allies in Japan and South Korea, and despite its long-standing relationship with dictators in some Asian countries, including South Korea and Taiwan and Indonesia, at certain moments it has withdrawn support from those dictators. It has embraced the democratic transformation of Asia. And that's a very different role than Great Britain has played since the end of its empire. So these are very different things. And they're the things that I think worry American policymakers about what's going on now with China policy. I don't think people think that Great Britain is capable of Well, Great Britain is capable of playing a very complicating role. And as we saw about 15 years ago, less, there was a big debate over ending the EU arms embargo on China. And during those debates, a lot of Europeans came to Washington and said, look, we don't need to do this. You're just being really proprietary about your relationships with China. We want to get in on this, and we don't take it seriously. And it took a long time. First of all, the United States was very slow to see this as a problem, and when they did, I think there was a lack of coordination. You know, the Asia departments of the State Department and the Europeans had to sort of get together and tell each other what this mutual interest was in U.S. foreign policy. But they did, and eventually, you know, there was a decision not to lift the EU arms embargo. My understanding is that it's being violated in spirit, that it remains on the books, but that plenty of countries, I don't think Great Britain so much, but France and Germany in particular, I think, do sell things that are complicating or have the potential to complicate America's defense of Taiwan, for example. This, to me, should be much more discussed across the Atlantic, and is very worrisome. So it's in that context that I say, although there are a lot of similarities between now in Great Britain's approach to China, and I've seen it, and I don't like where it leads, I'm even a little more concerned because we're at a point in the world where China has gotten much stronger, is much more confident, and is ideologically, if not, you know, promoting communism, is clearly propagating a sort of an authoritarian vision and value that we all need to worry about. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Ellen. In fact, we don't have much time. We have only half an hour left for question answering this session. We'll keep it brief now. What we'll have is the one issue that was mentioned, but we haven't discussed so far, was of course about religious persecution. We have a person here who ideally would have been here on the panel and might have been the only Chinese person on the panel. None of them is Chinese from what I know, right? We have Bob Fu from China. I know he wanted to say something and I wanted him to speak for a couple of minutes, if you may. But you have to be here.
Thank you very much for having me. My name is Bob Fu. I'm the founder and president of China Aid Association based in the United States as a human rights organization promoting religious freedom and rule of law in China. Just a quick, response, maybe very briefly. I think the state of the, the human rights or religious freedom in China. Maybe I should agree with the former UK ambassador said, yes, the human rights has been improved, but on which reference point? Compared to 50 years ago during the Cultural Revolution, where there's an anarchy, there's no judicial system existed, there's not such a lawyer system. Yes, today there are some lot of improvement. There is a government, there is maybe half a million lawyers in place, there is these different levels of course in the judicial system. But if we compare even like 2 years ago, before Xi Jinping's time, how could we claim there is any progress? I mean, where the lawyers are tried, not in the court first, but on CCTV, on the propaganda machine, where their family members were not even allowed to be issued a passport, a travel document. So certainly, this is almost unanimous conclusion among the human rights communities, certainly with many, government institutions. I know, in the CECC report, in the U.S. State Department annual human rights report, on the USERF, U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom report, these are all said very clearly. In the past 2 years, the record has been rapidly deteriorating. So that's my first point. My second point is I want to pick up the theme about constructive engagement. I think this is a false kind of paradigm. I think, as long as you're not engaging in the battlefield, any engagement is very constructive. It depends on what do you want to construct. Maybe you want to construct a nuclear plant. That's the only thing in your interest. But I would propose a principled engagement. I think China, in this sense, is right, in the sense that the Xi Jinping's regime claiming, this is our red line that we could not cross, the core national interest. The problem is that I think for even the country now, I'm, now a citizen of the United States, and of course the UK government, where is our red line? Where are our well-defined national interests? And are we just talking about improving the job, number or the GDP or growth as our only measurement of national interest? I think that is the problem we could really have a lot of discussion. And the religious freedom certainly has been, I think, as long as I documented with the figures from quantitative and qualitative numbers, has been the worst, I think, since the Cultural Revolution. And last year alone, there are over 1,500 churches. These are government-sanctioned, officially registered, protected churches. The crosses were totally destroyed. And some of the buildings, gigantic buildings, were totally destroyed. And the destruction continues. And we talk about, of course, the heavy kind of brutal crackdown in Tibet, in Xinjiang to the Uyghurs. Certainly the Falun Gong still have over 3,000 members in prison purely for exercising their freedom of conscience and religious belief. So this is really the worst situation. So I think, my proposal is the principled engagement. So we should really find out the principle where it stands. And finally, I want to basically read a statement from perhaps the most persistent statesman on human rights, especially in China, the former European Parliament vice chairman, Edward Macmillan Scott. This is because this is a statement from him. He asked me to read it. A statement on October 19th, 2015, to the Roundtable organized by the University of Westminster on the eve of the state visit by Chinese President Xi Jinping from Mr. Edward Macmillan Scott, former European Parliament Vice President for Democracy and Human Rights, a member of the Advisory Board of China Aid, and longstanding critic of the Beijing regime. My congratulations to Dr. Arnott for assembling an outstanding panel of China watchers and audience of experts. I'm sorry that I cannot be with you. This is the 20th anniversary of my report to the European Parliament on the EU-China strategy, including the so-called human rights dialogue. The hopes of so many in China were raised, but the reality for the EU has been business as usual, quote unquote, with China, and not politics as usual, quote unquote, as I urged then and still urge today. One more recent visit to China, I have been a firsthand witness of the arbitrary, brutal, and corrupt nature of the regime, especially in its treatment of religions, contrary to Article 36 of its constitution. Although not personally religious, my inspiration has been the Christian human rights lawyer Gao Zhisheng, first imprisoned in 2006 for his reports on persecution. He has been tortured repeatedly to the point of death and only recently, quote unquote, released into further house arrest. I believe, as he does, that change is coming to China, and that the hundreds of lawyers, civil society activists, and reformists who remain in prison will form part of the future government of a free China. Edward Macmillan Scott. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bob. Now, in fact, what we'll do is we'll take 3-4 questions. Hopefully we'll have that many questions, but 3-4 questions, and then we'll answer briefly, and then next round, and then we'll wind up. Who would like to start? Okay, Yankar, you start with him and then him there. So,
Hi.
Okay, first you and then pass it on to the gentleman there.
I think the table has suggested that Britain not complying with the human rights record of China would do anything other than alienate us from them.
So could you repeat that?
Yeah, sure. Basically, what I'm saying is that if we don't trade with China, then it's bad for us because we're going into European elections where we may be alienated from the continent. And if we don't agree with China on their human rights, and we say that we don't agree, all we're going to do is alienate ourselves from them. We're not going to help our position, and they're not going to change their position.
Okay, thank you. You have got the person there in back.
Hi, so my concern is when we speak about human rights as a tool of foreign policy or international trade, I think it's a great way of ensuring that other states do comply to high standards of human rights that we have set. But the only problem comes when maybe states like the United Kingdom, that's under discussion here, is also involved in some mass human rights violations. For example, if you have surveillance by the GCHQ, which is a major violation of privacy rights in the UK, as well as UK companies selling surveillance technology abroad, such as Gamma, that sold technology to Uganda, that was technology used which is quite the opposition in Uganda. And as far as, talking about territory is concerned, like we talked about Tibet here, but I think one thing that I find missing in academic and British debate is the question of the Falkland Islands, which is pretty much colonized by the British. There's a conflict, the resolutions in the Security Council over what is known as Malvinas, but the British is immediately named the Falkland Islands. So these are questions that also need to be addressed by maybe critics or academics of the state, and I feel like whenever we're talking about principles, stance, such as the last gentleman spoke about, there needs to go across the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
I think as a frequent speaker of high on the human rights situation trying to fight, I do agree. But to what extent do you think through our tools of foreign policy and trade, do you actually think we'll be able to influence human rights in China?
To what extent? Sorry, could you repeat that?
To what extent do you actually think, if we do take a stand on these issues, do you actually think we will actually have an impact on the human rights situation in China?
Okay, thanks. Next. Then. So we can all take all the questions together and have one answer in that sense. So that's it. Good. No, I had a long day.
History has shown the hypocrisy of the politicians. When Margaret Thatcher was the Prime Minister of Great Britain, she hardly spoke about Tibet. But after her retirement from politics and government, she wrote a book, I'm not sure how many of you must have read the book. In her autobiography, she says, Tibet historically was an independent country. And she also writes that China needs West more than West needs China. So you see all these double standards. So I'm just wondering, given the current David Cameron's honeymoon with the Chinese president, I'm wondering what sort of autobiography he would write once he retires and about his meeting with the Dalai Lama, and whether all these politicians, do they really enjoy peace of mind when dealing with dictators? Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions? Because if we don't, just please. Anyone else we encourage you to ask? You have noted down all the questions. Anyone? Could we might come back. Fine. Who want to start? Ellen, would you? Because there's four questions I'll read, actually you would have noted, but for the sake of my own sanity, or not sanity, sorry, clarity, I've had a long day. First one was about, can we really afford to talk about human rights issue in China? Because talk of human rights might harm the trade, and we need trade, and in any case it may not have an impact upon that. So I guess it could be that in any case you can't have an impact, and second, we need China for trade, because otherwise we will suffer economically. The second question was about what about UK's human rights abuses and its own record of surveillance and human rights, and all of that. And of course, UK's own history of and the present of colonization and disputes in different parts. So when UK has that, what right does it have, or why do we talk also of those kind of issues? Third question was related to the first one, to what extent can we actually have any impact on human rights in China? I mean, we may think we may have, but to what extent we might have any impact. And fourth was more of a comment kind of thing.
and because we don't know what autobiography that, oh, sorry, this novel that David Cannon would be writing, and I don't want to speculate, but the comment was of hypocrisy of politicians, where a number of politicians in private or after retirement have talked of human rights, Dalai Lama, Tibet, and all of that, but when in government, they would never do that, right? So in terms of to what extent, how do politicians speak? I don't know, I'm not a politician, I don't see with politicians also, so I wouldn't know that. But anyway, broadly, these are the four questions. Ellen, would you like to start?
Okay, sure, I'd like to stipulate that politicians are hypocritical, and this is to be expected. I think it's important to not view these as sort of beauty pageant among governments, or politicians. It's the question is, which kind of system best protects people's rights and best runs a society? And I would say that a democracy is better, and it's for its faults. So that which is not to diminish the importance of dealing with any government abuse or bad policy. But I do think that that's a fundamental difference. That needs to be taken into account when we're criticizing China. It's not. It's about giving people. As I think Churchill said, it's the best form of democracy. Is the best form of government, except for
all the others.
So that's one point. I think in terms of being able to have an impact, I can see how frustrated everyone is. Is because it really requires consistency and unity, and we haven't had either of those, either within particular governments. I'm personally very interested in the idea that the Europeans could resist China's very effective diplomacy and pressure tactics by having a more unified policy and protecting each other. I realize that's a lot to ask, but I think that's the only way to make progress. What else did I?
Rights of Chinese activists and in support of Chinese activists. We have to be humble about how much we can do, how much impact the international community can have. I just happen to work on China, but many other people work on other countries. I worked for Amnesty for many years, trying to support Chinese activists. At the same time that we have to be humble about how limited we are as an international civil society, I think that it is also incredibly important that we stand in support of activists all around the world. People are sacrificing. Human rights lawyers, Chinese human rights lawyers are regular people with children, and then they get imprisoned for 12 years, and their children are left without parents. The impact on them is huge. And even just, having international organizations supporting them is huge in their morale, knowing that they're not alone. Even just having letters sent to people in prison. Maybe we're not fundamentally changing things in China, and we have to remain very limited, realistic in how much we can impact. But even just sending some letters to people around the world in prison, is huge for their feeling that they have support, that they're not left alone, especially from those regions of the world where they aspire to the principles that they look to Europe, they look to the United States, they look to these places. They want a free press, they want rule of law, they are looking to us, to at least recognize and to speak out for them. And when our politicians don't do that, it makes them, it's a kind of a feeling of despair, of looking to us in a sense, or looking to countries that stand up for those, and Chinese activists feel particularly frustrated because they see the double standard. They feel, in the Arab Spring, there's so much support for democracy, activists and democracy movements in those regions, and yet China tried to have its own little democracy, Arab sort of China, Jasmine Revolution. It tried, and yet it felt like there was no support coming from overseas. So as international civil society, we have to pressure our politicians. Even if they're cynical, we have to still continue to try to pressure them. Even if it's somewhat symbolic, that symbolism is still important. And as international NGOs can do a huge amount. So when the feminists in China were detained, there were five feminists that were detained, there was a huge upsurge, you know, internationally. And that actually, the Chinese government released those women in response to a really big, you know, campaign around the globe. Now, it's very hard to work on all the issues in China or all around the globe. It's very, very difficult, but they do respond when there is really a broad kind of upsurge. So I think it is important, you know, that we just don't give up, you know, on people, you know, who are trying to make change in their countries.
Thank you for pulling the
room. Sure. I think it's a mistake to fall into this, you know, do we maintain our principles or do we trade with China trope? But that's simply not the case. We will be trading with China for a long time without being obliged to abandon its own democratic principles. In the most, as I said earlier on, the most successful trading nations vis-a-vis China are Germany and the United States. They have not behaved the way the UK government is currently behaving. So, and it worked for them, right? So it's not an either or is what I'm saying. On the UK and the violation of human rights, absolutely. I also said that, you know, this is a discourse full of hypocrisy and one that on a government to government level is deeply problematic. I don't think that it's terribly helpful to bring in the Falkland Malvinas into this dispute, because I think you do an enormous disservice to the people of Tibet and Xinjiang by that comparison. It really is, whatever the merits, the sovereignty claims over the Malvinas or Falklands, this is absolutely not the same situation. You know, there is no oppressed local population of Argentinians who are being, you know, who have been occupied by the British. I mean, just look at the history of the Falklands. It's completely different, and I think that, you know, we should be a little more moderate in our, you know, yes, but what about, you know, approach to these questions. You know, we can relativize ourselves out of existence. In terms of whether we make a difference in China, well, I think that the window is closing, but I do think that the Chinese concern about what is said about China is still highly visible. Otherwise, why would they exercise so much pressure for everyone to be quiet about human rights violations? I think that they matter. I would also say that we have spoken about human rights in terms of the violation of political rights, particularly over lawyers in prison. I don't dissent from any of that. I mean, I think things have got much tougher in China in the last couple of years. But in that panorama of how tough things have got, you have some quite unusual entities voicing their concern. For instance, the EU Chamber of Commerce put in a very strong statement when the consultation on the new security law and the consultation on the new law on international NGOs in China was invited. You don't normally see the EU Chamber of Commerce pitching in on NGO activity, but they made a point that there is a continuum between the context in which business is conducted, which also needs transparency, accountability, and the rule of law, and the context in which civil society is allowed to conduct its business, and made the point that business actually refers to and needs civil society just as much as individuals or citizens do. So I think that we can compartmentalize this too much, and I think that those who encourage us to compartmentalize it are also doing so for their own purposes.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks. I would basically echo points already, the point that has already been made, that really I think we have to think about the effects of what we are doing in terms of speaking up critically about these crackdowns, the deteriorating human rights situation. We have to think of also the effects of not doing anything. I don't think that we have a choice, essentially, of sort of staying completely out of the picture. My personal experience is also very much that we shouldn't underestimate the importance of moral support given to people who work inside these authoritarian systems and to whom it really does make a difference to be in communication with people on the outside, entities on the outside, who simply give them a feeling of not being alone. The feeling of being alone can be very, very devastating in a very repressive system. And I think connected to that, sort of that basic point, we don't have a choice of not doing anything, not producing any effect on China and similar countries. I would also make the point, and that goes a little bit to the question about how can we criticize human rights violations in China when we have so many human rights violations of our own, and in the context of the so-called war on terror, the situation in our countries has deteriorated as well. Well, I would say that, of course, another way of looking at that situation is to say that the rise of autocracy that has been mentioned, I think, by two of the previous speakers, has also been seen as a kind of global trend that also unfortunately affects countries that continue to look at themselves as liberal democratic. Think about the issues that we have with surveillance, think about the issues we've had with detention of terrorism suspects, etc., etc. But if you want to draw a lesson from that, I think that it is that there is a bit of a risk of a global authoritarian rise, and I would rather dread, you know, the day on which instead of merely saying, oh, we have to learn from countries like China who have risen in terms of their wealth, their economies, prosperity, etc., we might hear politicians sort of suggest that if successful countries like these engage in surveillance and in sort of harsher, more restrictive control of their citizenship, maybe that's the right thing. Maybe we need to copy those policies as well. So I think that if we take seriously the possibility of a global rise in authoritarianism, then of course the lesson to draw from that, I think, is that we have to continue with increased sort of vigor in being critical of human rights violations wherever they happen.
Yes. To the question, can we afford economically to raise human rights? Yes, we can. And not because I'm trying to play Obama on the campaign trail. You have one country in Europe that has suffered because of Chinese grievances and protests because of what they did on human rights, and which is still suffering, and is suffering politically. And this is Norway. And the reason was because Norway awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, I mean, not Norway as a government, but the Nobel Committee, to Liu Xiaobo. And since then, China has decided to freeze all high political level contacts with Norway. They haven't lost one krona in terms of trade with China. It's a question of politics. It's not a question of money. Don't buy the rhetoric that if you don't appease China politically, you're going to lose your job. This is not true. It hasn't been proven for the UK, for the US, for Germany. As was mentioned, the US and Germany have the more outspoken policy on human rights vis-a-vis China. Why? Because they have business interests, so they can afford to talk more. So it's not that reason. So you're not going to lose human rights. They need to gain political legitimacy, and so they want foreign governments to stop criticizing, but they don't want to stop doing business. They need to do business with Europe and with the United States still. So this is, I think, very important, and which is not coming out in the unfortunately, in the political debate, and we need more research actually on this. I think it would be very important if more, you know, think tanks and universities could study the economic trends between China and other countries and see how the political relationship links or doesn't link with the with this issue. Finally, on the issue of Tibet, also to my friend there, I want to say one thing. Tibet is a test case. If China has not been able to find a political solution, or is not willing to find a political solution with the Tibetans, which have been led by, you know, 5 decades in exile by the Dalai Lama, who is a Nobel Peace Prize, one of the highest moral authorities in the world, and has been proposing to grant more autonomy to the Tibetans and not independence. If you're not able to try to find a deal with the Tibetans, what are they going to do in other cases? I mean, this is the direction of a very nationalistic government that needs to strengthen its own authoritarian rule. They are investing more in internal security than in military expenses because they need to consolidate internal power. So when you look at Tibet, you know, it's one case of an occupied people and country that was independent, but it's something that it doesn't stop there. If they win there, if they win in Xinjiang, they start to move now again on the South China Sea, and there will be other things to fuel these nationalistic sentiments. So this is something that should be looked at with a wider perspective.
Thank you. And in fact, I have to sum up everything up because it's already 8 o'clock. But a few ideas I've got from all different speakers and questions and other things, and ideas that came to mind. But before that, remember Jeremy Hunt? He was the one who talked of his Chinese wife, right? Jeremy Hunt. Yeah. So British Health Secretary, if I'm not mistaken. I don't care about the politicians. I don't pay attention. But he apparently said that British people should work harder, more like workers from China and America. But then he said, I can say it because my wife is Chinese. Now, the subtext of that, of course, is that Chinese work harder, British people are lazy, British workers don't really do much, and therefore we have to work harder, right? But there's a fantasy that a number of people, not only few, number of people have in the West about what the work ethic is in China, completely ignoring the fact that workers have no rights within a worker state. So that is the kind of ideal that they're proposing there, right? But something which we have talked of is almost politics of fear that the party state is using, and how this illusion or hope that many had in when Xi Jinping came to power is gone. So in fact, what we have is a situation, not that human rights are bad, but it's getting much worse, and it's worse since Cultural Revolution. So we have a situation of not only bad human rights situation, but deteriorating human rights situation. We have also something which we couldn't focus on, but maybe we should work more on it, is when we talk of Xi Jinping, we are focusing on personality politics. When we are talking for party state, so if Xi Jinping wasn't in power, someone else was, would it really make a difference? Or is the problem more than the leader? It's to do with the entire system of authoritarianism that functions and flourishes in China. It is about asymmetric relation. From one where British were the colonialists to one where no one was colonialist vis-a-vis each other, till 2008 where and this is where Chinese diplomacy is smart, you have to at least respect them for that. They ended up getting acknowledgement from UK on Tibet around certain things without giving anything in return, right? And until then they kept accusing Britain of still holding on to empire while justifying their own empire in Tibet and Xinjiang, right? So you had that, but it's largely asymmetric now, where you see Chinese leaders talking of Britain as a good destination for studying or visiting or, I don't know, having tea or something like that. But Britain is the one that says, we need China. China doesn't say we need Britain. Partly because, of course, you have a problem where Britain is small, no doubt. Germany is also not that big. But Europe on its own is very strong, but Europeans can't agree with each other that they are strong. Right? So we have that problem. We have studied and we have to focus on the assertion of the party state, how it behaves, use of, and the question of to what extent the dilemma of economic versus moral is a false dilemma, because you could do both. There have been studies that show that meeting the Dalai Lama doesn't cost any country anything severe economically.
So economic relations with the UK did not fall apart when David Cameron met Dalai Lama. It's more symbolic. Now what we have is a different situation. Leaders here are elected for 5 years at most. So they're looking for next election. Creating jobs are important. Now leaders, they don't need to, they don't need to do anything for legitimacy except be in power. So here what happens is, by saying that, oh, big leaders are coming, China is promising to invest. And a good research would be one also done on what Chinese promise vis-a-vis MOUs and what actually happens. Because from what I have heard, vis-a-vis France, what happened in 2009, 2010 was 90% of what they promised and MOUs signed did not become practical. Right? So it's also China good, Chinese are good at, when it's Chinese, even Chinese state is good at using those things. In terms of hope, if only hope is when China fails internally, and that it's a very sad hope, but maybe who knows what happens. But it goes back to the question of, I mean, the gentleman there who asked it, what right do we have or why focus only on China and not on other things? I mean, look, that kind of question is very important, no doubt. But it's not really relevant because when we talk of, let's say, UK's imperialism, human rights abuse in UK, we don't really talk of China and say, oh, it's not as bad as China and justify it, right? So when we, and I'm sure, I'm putting, but when we raise issues of struggles for democracy elsewhere, the question is, if we, I mean, we should not support struggle for democracy, human rights, anti-occupation and everything in China because China is unique, uniquely evil. I mean, at least my personal position. We should support it, we should support it everywhere. So let us support it in, I don't know, I always bring in Kashmir, let's support it in Tibet, let's support it in UK, let's support it in Scotland, let's support wherever we have to. So we should always compare to highlight human rights abuses rather than allow a situation where you say, what right does US have after invading Iraq and others to talk of China? I'll tell you this, but there's a slight difference. We can have this event here, and I've been talking of things which you could see, or we have been talking of things that are not palatable to David Cameron or Osborne, right? And I don't think we fear being put into prison for this so far. We don't fear being told off for what we have done so far. I say so far because there's struggle. In China, you cannot have anything. We had, you know, Palestinian march on Saturday. We could go and at least express solidarity. It may not have much impact, but at least some of us could do it. Now, imagine in China, you cannot have any solidarity march with anyone unless the government approves. And that is a big difference vis-a-vis democracy and non-democracy, where within democracy, we can struggle for better democracy. We can use democracy to push back, and use the word push back, the state. In authoritarian system, the rule of law doesn't exist because the rule of the state is over the rule of the law. Right? I think I said it rightly. So overall, to summarize, I would like to thank all of you, thank all the speakers here, thank Bob Fu, thank, I forget his name, but you know, the MEP from Scott, sorry, I don't know. I'm really grateful for him to having sent his message of support. Thank you to all of you. But let's take from this in mind that, look, the question is not, you may not agree that, look, what we have said. But the spirit here is very clear that any government we have to, as people, remember, we are not governments here. None of us are in government, are we? No. Okay, we are not in government. The purpose is not to what kind of policy we have, but as activists, as academics, as commentators, as scholars, as whatever we are, as students, as lawyers, or whatever, should we just accept the status quo because that's easier to do, or should we challenge and push back at everywhere? And the message I think we would like to give from you is that we need to push back. Because if we don't, who else will? Thank you very much.
Yeah,